Okay, thank you. So I'm here in my role as the UK representative to BBMRI Eric. I am a law lecturer at the University of Sheffield. So I want to present to you a view on consent that is kind of an emerging view in the UK, and it might be quite controversial by European standards. So the GDPR has very specific requirements in relation to consent to use of health data. And the precursor to that Data Protection Directive, we also see that we have very specific requirements in relation to consent, that people are required to give explicit consent to uses of their data. But consent is one amongst a number of legal bases for processing data. And what we find is that there's a number of other legal bases for legal bases for processing personal identifiable data. And actually there's some quite wide exceptions in both the Data Protection Directive and in the General Data Protection Regulation that allow member states to lay down provisions for uses of data in the public interest without gaining consent. So one of the kind of themes underpinning my position is that we should protect consent as the legal basis for the use of identifiable patient data in the context of these alternatives. Using consent as the legal basis for use of data will protect the kind of principles that the legal framework wants to protect, such as transparency, trust, and patient autonomy. And if you protect those kinds of principles, then you're much more likely to gain public support and have a sustainable approach to using using data. And I don't think it's any exaggeration to say that confidential patient information must flow for health systems to actually operate at the most optimal level, and also for health research to be as fulfill its potential. And as this becomes more and more apparent and we move into things like using algorithms and using big data sets in the context of machine learning, we are collecting more and more data and using it in more and more applications, which could make consent, individual consent, much harder to achieve. And actually, if we're trying to achieve consent from large numbers of people, if we make the requirements of consent arduous, then again we start to force reliance onto other legal bases than consent. So my argument here is not necessarily to support the legal bases other than consent. It's not to diminish patient autonomy. The argument is more, if we make consent too difficult to achieve, we actually diminish patient autonomy by forcing reliance onto other legal bases than consent. So how is consent defined in the European regulation? Well, the Data Protection Directive and the General Data Protection Regulation have quite a specific approach to defining consent. They require that consent is freely given, which I think is fairly uncontentious. And we know that they both require explicit consent on the first slide, but they also require consent to be specific and informed. And I think, as we've heard from some of the previous talks, this can be quite difficult in the context of using health data, because it may not be clear at the outset, when you need to gain consent for the use, what you're actually going to be doing with that data. And if we're trying to achieve that in large numbers, that can be problematic. Equally, if we're thinking about retrospective consent, trying to achieve consent for new purposes. So the question that I want to ask is there a place for a less specific and relatively uninformed consent? And what might this look like? Like I said, I think it's uncontentious that there are some very basic requirements of any consent, that it must be freely given, it shouldn't be given in the context of any undue influence, and that it must be underpinned by relevant information. But I think the important question here is, how do we interpret this notion of relevant information? So people often talk about informed consent in the context of uses of health data. And what I want to argue is that we shouldn't really be using that terminology, given that informed consent is a concept that has developed in the UK at least, and I think this is quite similar in most places across Europe. It's a legal term that's developed in the context of consent to medical treatment. So when you're consenting to medical treatment, you're actually consenting to two different elements. You consent to the physical intervention, and you also consent to the risks associated with that physical intervention. And it's only in relation to the second strand here, the risks associated with that physical intervention, that the concept of informed consent bites. When we're thinking about consent to the physical intervention, in the UK, the law doesn't talk about informed consent. It just requires that you're broadly aware of the physical intervention that you're consenting to. It's when we start talking about running physical risks that the notion of informed consent is relevant. So for us, informed consent is all about running risk, running personal physical risk, which is generally quite an important aspect to people. They don't want to be subjected to significant physical risks without having information about the level of those risks and the severity of those risks. And that's what informed consent is all about. So the question is, which of these informational foci is more relevant to the use of health data? Should we be thinking about broad consent, being broadly aware of the nature of what's going to happen? Or are we more concerned about informed consent and being fully informed of all the potential risks and alternatives? And I would argue that it's much more clearly the latter. When we're thinking about, when we're thinking about consent to uses of health data, what people want to know is, well, what kinds of use are you talking about? What are the things that you think are legitimate uses of my health data that I need to know about? Because then I can decide whether or not I think they are legitimate and decide whether or not they should happen. I would argue that what people are not consenting to here is running risk. Of course, there are risks when you consent to the use of your health data, but those risks usually concern wrongful, unlawful, or negligent activity, and that's not something that you can consent to. I wouldn't want to give a consent to that and assume that that consent would then protect the data controller or the data processor in the event of their negligence. I don't think, obviously, consent does act as a legal protection for data controllers and data processors, but it shouldn't do in the event of negligence or wrongdoing or illegal activity. So again, it's making us question, well, why are we using this notion of informed consent? Because informed consent is all about risks, whereas what you want to know is, well, what are the legitimate uses? What are the things that you're going to do? Could you just be broadly aware of those without having to know about all of the potential alternatives, as long as you're aware of a certain genus of use with your data? Another distinction that's made between a broad consent and an informed consent, in the UK we talk about broad consent being real consent. We say a real consent is one that you give when you're broadly aware of the nature of medical treatment. Is that it's up to the clinicians to decide what information you need to give a broad consent. The law says you are broadly aware if the clinician gives you the kind of information that other reasonable clinicians would support. That means that the profession can put boundaries around the information, which makes it easier for them to determine their duty. Okay, so we all come together, this is the relevant information we need to give to patients. If we do that, then we've achieved the level that we need to discharge our duty. Informed consent is much more patient focused, and in informed consent the law says that you need to give the particular patient in front of you the information that a reasonable person in their position would want. This has had clinicians up in arms in the UK because they feel it's an unachievable position They have to assess materiality in relation to every patient that they see. And now they're asking, do we have, if informed consent applies to health data, do we have to assess materiality in relation to everybody we consent and the kind of things that are going to be relevant to them given the particular situation that they're in? And as you can see, this would be quite a very arduous duty to place on data controllers, data processing people, consenting people to the use of, to uses of health data. So this is gradually forcing reliance onto other legal bases than consent. And we actually have a statutory position now that allows a committee to consider patient data and allow uses of confidential patient data without consent. And this committee is completely inundated with requests because people are not gaining consent and they're instead going down this route of using this advisory committee to justify uses of data. So how might we set some informational standards that might try and achieve a broad awareness that are acceptable to the public, that don't start to diminish public trust in organisations using data because they think that we're bypassing consent? I mean, the first thing that we could do is kind of eschew this language of informed consent that comes with the legal baggage of 30 years of putting the patient at the heart of the of determining what information is relevant, and instead have governance structures that are based more on public acceptability and public awareness. In the UK, there's significant information, empirical research, determining what people find acceptable with regard to uses of their health data. And it may be that acceptability could be, what's acceptable to the public, could be the first step in determining the kinds of information that we need to give people before we gain a consent to the use of health data. But just because, well, if we start from acceptability, we might then say if the public finds something acceptable, they might reasonably expect that to happen. Although these two are not entirely synonymous, you might argue that acceptability, if something's acceptable, it might influence an expectation that ought to happen. And what we find is that people are very, very accepting of any kind of use of data that has a public interest at heart. So they don't necessarily feel that they should have a lot of information about those kinds of uses. The things that people do not find acceptable are any uses that have a commercial element or have a profit, for-profit aim as its major priority. So given this, we might argue that a broad consent could focus quite specifically on those kinds of uses that people find unacceptable. And those things that the data, we've done lots and lots of empirical surveys, show that people find acceptable, we wouldn't need to give lots of information about those. We assume that people reasonably expect that. And given that, those kinds of uses do actually represent the majority of uses of people's data in the biobanking context, we might find that consent could be relatively easily achieved by giving quite minimal information about your information, what your data will be used in projects that will benefit the health of mankind. So then you get a kind of hierarchy of the sorts of things that you might, the sorts of situations where you might need to give a greater amount of information. So if you're looking at an acceptable use by an acceptable organisation, we might say you need very minimal information in order to gain consent to that, because we know that people find that acceptable as a public health institution. So people find that acceptable. So let's make consent easy to achieve. Let's not force reliance onto other legal bases. Let's try and protect autonomy rather than sort of bypass the individual's ability to make a choice here. And then we move down. So we've got acceptable by not so acceptable institutions, because it's uses and institutions that people find the most important in determining what they think is legitimate with regard to uses of their health data. Down to this, the last one, which is the not so acceptable use by the not so acceptable organisation. And we may want to think about whether we want to craft the uses to completely exempt that kind of use, so that we know that the kinds of uses that are crafted actually represent the kind of things that people find acceptable. Therefore, we don't need to give them huge amounts of information about things that they are going to be concerned and worried about. So, I hope that that shows you how I think that actually taking an approach to consent that does not focus on informed consent as developed in the context of consent to medical treatment might allow consent to be the basis of data processing, particularly if it means we don't have to start assessing materiality in every case. And hopefully this might contribute to more safe and effective healthcare in the long run. Thank you for listening.